In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. In fact, preaching the gospel gives me nothing to boast of, for I am under compulsion and should be in trouble if I fail to do it. If I did it on my own initiative, I would deserve a reward. But if I do it under compulsion, I am simply accepting the task entrusted to me. What reward do I have then? That in my preaching, I offer the gospel free of charge to avoid using the rights which the gospel allows me. God-loving Father, who called your son, Saint Junipero, from his home, family, and studies to offer the peoples of California the word made flesh, send your spirit of wisdom and consolation upon us. Through Saint Junipero's intercession, may our conversation lead us to the truth, who is your son. Unite our nation, Lord, heal our divisions, and bring peace to all. Be with Father James and with all of us gathered here as we strive eagerly to hear and understand your word. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
In the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
So once again, welcome to everyone, especially to welcome Father James to this event given by the St. Francis Xavier Lay Missionary Society. So just for those three people that don't know who Father James is, shame on you. But to get everyone on the same page, Father James is a Dominican priest serving as the Vicar for Advancement for the Western Dominican Province. He has graduated with his bachelor's from Santa Clara University, where he would oftentimes pray at the statue of St. Junipero Serra. He has a master's from Notre Dame, as well as for the Dominican School of Philosophy and Theology, and he is completing his doctoral studies at the Catholic University of America. So there are so many things to say about Father James, this beautiful brother of the Western Province, but without further ado, Father James, take it over.
Thank you, Father Isaiah Mary. Yes, so I'm actually, all this work that he just talked about, all that academic work, was primarily, it was done in philosophy and theology, of course, to be a priest, but also most of that academic work was done in music, actually. That's my academic area, is in sacred music. I'm an organist and a choir director. And because of that, any of you who are YAG people here tonight know that all my YAG talks always have theology and have also sacred music in them. So this one is a special talk tonight because I've chosen some sacred music to listen to that is sacred music very connected with St. Junipero Serra himself. The first piece I'd like, Trish is actually going to do this, she's going to play. It is called Albricias Mortales, and this is actually from Mexico City Cathedral. So an interesting thing, you know, we're talking a lot about different cultures these days, you know, and when the whole arguments about racism and this sort of thing have happened. A very interesting thing happened. I'm going to talk a little bit about this in the talk today, but in Middle America, you had a native culture sort of collide with a Spanish culture, unlike happened here where we had cultural collisions more, and especially in the eastern United States. And what tended to happen was that native cultures tended to be driven out oftentimes, whereas in Middle America, there tended to be this kind of collision and a new thing was born. And that also included music and art and architecture. And so there's a unique Mexican Baroque. I hate to say it, in the United States at that point, there wasn't much sort of involvement in music. There weren't too many musical.
Oops.
Ah,
tomate.
So I just got, anyway, so without further ado, well, let's begin with this music. This is Albricias Mortales, and it is music from the Mexico City Cathedral around the time that St. Junipero Serra lived and worked in Mexico City itself. It's likely he would have heard this music, and it was music that we used at the offertory at his canonization mass. I helped plan that music for that canonization mass and was actually in the choir for it.
Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you, Trish. This music from the Mexico City Cathedral is a great example of this. It was by Manuel de Sumaya. Manuel de Sumaya was born in the New World, quote unquote. He actually lived in Oaxaca and was there, studied for a long time, and then eventually came to Mexico City to be director of the Cathedral of Music there. If you'll notice, that music is very late Baroque, early classical music. So any of you who are music people know kind of the transition between Bach and Mozart. And very important, because this is the context that Saint Junipero Serra was coming into the New World. I'm going to talk about this, but one of his main tactics, as the Spaniards and the Portuguese missionaries had done from the beginning, was the way of beauty, the via pulchritudinis, as Pope Francis likes to say. So in my talk today, I want to talk, sort of elucidate a little bit some of the history, the historical context that Saint Junipero Serra came into when he came to be a missionary in the New World, quote unquote. And also, I want to talk about his life in general. And then I want to talk about some of the legacy, and including some outright falsehoods that are perpetuated about him. And then some issues that are controversial, and why they're controversial, and sort of getting backgrounds of why he did them, or why he went about doing them. And do I think he's a saint? You better believe it. In fact, my religious name is Father James Junipero Moore. Father Isaiah Mary alluded to the fact that I used to pray by his statue. I went to university at Santa Clara, and when I was trying to discern entrance into the Dominicans, being all angsty as a college senior, you know, thinking I still like girls, I don't know what to do, and having this feeling, this call from the Lord, though, to join the Dominicans. And I would practice the mission church late at night. Santa Clara is one of the missions that St. Junipero founded. And I'd be walking back to my car, and I'd pass his statue, and I thought, I remember you as a kid, and now you're blessed. I'm going to ask for your intercession. And he brought me here. I've been studying St. Junipero Serra probably since I was about 4 or 5. My mom got tired of reading us children's books when we were little, and so she said, you know what, we're going to read California history instead. So she got out books about the missions, and then, of course, when we traveled, we could go visit the mission churches. And I remember as a little kid, 5 or 6 years old, visiting that mission in Carmel, and mom saying, you know, they're going to declare him to be a saint one day. And I was amazed in 2015 when I was there present when Pope Francis canonized him, and able to tell my mom, hey, mom, you remember when you said that? Today's the day. So anyway, without further ado, I want to go ahead and talk a little bit. Like I said, this talk is sort of in three parts. The first part, the historical context that St. Junipero Serra walked into. Second of all, his life. Third part, controversy. First part, the historical context. St. Junipero Serra came at the very end of one of the greatest missionary periods in the church's history, perhaps the greatest missionary period since the time of the apostles, or since at least the time of Constantine. And it was the missionary period that went actually two directions. One went to the west and the other went to the east. This great missionary period started with Portuguese explorers headed to the east, Bartolomeu Dias, and then also Vasco da Gama, who went to Bartolomeu Dias, the first one to go around the Horn of Africa from Europe, and then Vasco da Gama actually going to India, discovering these great new civilizations there, some of which were actually Christian already at that point. And so the interaction of the Portuguese missionaries, and then, of course, very soon going to China, which is where the St. Francis Missionary Society loves to go to, right? Named for their great patron, Francis Xavier. Then also, this was late 1400s, again, late 15th century. 1488 was when Diaz went around the Horn of Africa. 1492, as we all know, Columbus sailed the ocean blue and ran into a whole new group of people here in the Americas. And very quickly after that, missionary activity began. Now, there was a horrible controversy at the beginning about this. There were actually some people that wanted to argue that, in fact, these the native peoples of the New World, quote unquote, were actually sort of less than human somehow, and didn't possess the qualities needed to be human, therefore we could naturally enslave them and exploit them. Well, Dominicans kind of came to the rescue at that point, and under the leadership of Diego de Deza, who is one of the court chaplains, argued using something that Father Isaiah Mary and I use a lot, Aristotelian philosophy, that philosophy of Aristotle, to prove that these, in fact, were rational beings that they'd run into, and if they're rational beings, they have human dignity, and as human dignity, they're worthy of the gospel. Right? We should preach them. we should evangelize, and you can't enslave them if that's the case. They have dignity as persons. And very soon after that, the papacy actually issued is really strong in indictments against slavery. Didn't stop some people from doing it, of course, as papal injunctions on moral things often don't, people still don't follow them. But this is one of the same kinds of things. Okay, so in the New World, evangelization was undertaken by some of the greatest religious orders at the time, the Dominicans, the Franciscans, and then a little bit later, the Carmelites, the Augustinians, and after they were founded, the Jesuits. Now, what would often happen would be a particular religious order would be given a territory that they were responsible for evangelizing in. The Dominican territories tended to be in the center of Mexico and in the south of Mexico. So Oaxaca, Chiapas, and then around Mexico City itself, and Puebla as also in the center of the Republic. The Jesuits had some missions there too, but the Jesuits also were charged with ministering to the north. So a little bit about that. The New World was not just a simple set of homogeneous peoples, right? There were different tribes, different sort of civilizations that had already grown up here. Hernan Cortes, the big conquistador in Mexico, when he came in, of course, he's known for encountering the Aztec civilization, but he also encountered many other tribes of natives, and some of them actually helped him rise up and defeat the Aztec Empire. Part of it, some of these tribes were actually sick of the Aztecs because they practiced human sacrifice. They kidnapped their people and enslaved them and also did this human sacrifice thing. So they were ready to go with Cortez. So it wasn't everybody, but there were definitely groups that did this. Cortez then begins sort of establishing Spanish rule, and missionaries follow. Missionaries, of course, had a hard time at the beginning. Of course, they were part of a foreign power coming in, but they were quickly helped by the Mother of God herself. We all know the story of Our Lady of Guadalupe. She appeared not as a Spanish woman, not as a European woman, but she appeared as an Aztec princess. She appeared as an Aztec princess appearing in the culture she was coming to evangelize and speaking the language of the people that she was coming, speaking Nahuatl to Saint Juan Diego, and of course the miraculous image that is on the Tilma, which is still in Mexico City today. So there's kind of this kind of enculturation, and the Mother of God herself kind of leading it. Like, by the way, this is a universal faith, and here I am actually looking like you and speaking like you and speaking your language, and I'm your mother. And so this beautiful sort of leading the way for evangelization and sort of salting the field, you know, sort of seasoning and plowing the field for evangelization here in the quote-unquote New World. California. So Hernan Cortez actually made it to California, to Baja California. To remember, California is a long territory, and half of it is in Mexico, half is in the United States today. At that point, of course, it was this long peninsula, which we now know as Baja California, and the upper part, which was referred to as Alta California, or Upper California. Hernan Cortes got here in 1535, but wasn't too successful in staying. All subsequent attempts to stay in Baja California were failures until the late 1690s, 1697, which is incredibly late. European explorers did go up the coast of California. The first European we know of that came up the coast of what is now Alta California was a Portuguese sailor, at least most people think he was Portuguese, João Cabrillo, who sailed under the Spanish king, so he's often referred to as Cabrillo, the Spanish pronunciation, and got as far north as what we think is now Drake's Bay, maybe even further north, and then he died on San Miguel Island and the Channel Islands off the coast of Southern California. That was 1543, I think, 1542, 43. 60 years later, Sebastian Vizcaino in 1602 came. First mass we know celebrated at Monterey, celebrated there, and they erected a big cross, which by the way was still there when the Padres returned in 1770, 167 years later, 168 years later. And Sebastian Vizcaino came as far north, we think, again, as maybe Drake's Bay. They all missed San Francisco. Why? The Golden Gate's always fogged in, right? Or almost always fogged in. And they kept missing it. The ships would go by. They had no idea that big port was there. They knew about San Diego. They knew about Monterey. They knew about Drake's Bay. but they didn't know San Francisco. And for the next 160 years, the Spaniards didn't do much about these finds. They knew that these were there, and they knew that they were beautiful lands. There's a lot of speculation about this. One of the big things, though, is California is not that easy to live with if you don't have an adequate water supply, right? And until you could dig a deep well or do what we did in the early 20th century, which is just move entire rivers to feed our population, it was hard to sustain a large population. So I think that might be one of the reasons. Another reason was Spain was embroiled in a lot of problems. But it wasn't till 1769 when the Portola and the Galvez expedition came up north from Baja California and sailed up from Mexico that the Spaniards came really, quote unquote, to stay in Alta California. So that's sort of the background of the general history. I want to talk about Saint Junipero Serra, but any questions about that? I mean, especially Trish or Father Isaiah Mary or anybody else? Great, okay, so hopefully this clears the bell. I talk a lot of fast stuff. So Saint Junipero Serra. Saint Junipero Serra is often said as a Spaniard, kind of. Remember, Spain is a diverse place itself, and it was only united in 1492 by the union of the Catholic kings Ferdinand and Isabel. And so there are many, many dialects, even say some would say separate languages spoken in Spain. Saint Junipero Serra was part of this. He was not from the Spanish mainland. He was from the island of Mallorca, which is in the Balearic Islands, which are in the Mediterranean Sea. I think it was actually Mallorca that in the Middle Ages, Saint Raymond of Peñafort actually came and went over to warn the king of Aragon about a plot, but that's Dominican history. Saint Junipero Serra was born in 1713. He was born to a very pious family, and he had a number of siblings, but a lot of them died. This is infant mortality, huge in those times. And there was a lot of sickness, a lot of plague even then. I mean, something we're familiar with now. And he was born into this family, and he was very close to one of his sisters. This sister actually eventually, one of her sons became a Franciscan as well. He became a Capuchin Franciscan. Junipero Serra, already from the time he was a kid, he worked out in the fields with his family, but as a kid, he already shown some signs of piety and also a keen sense of learning. And he wanted to be a priest. And he entered the Franciscans when he was 16. People tended to figure out their lives a lot faster back in those days. And in there in Mallorca, entered, went through the novitiate. They were a little bit worried about him because he was so tiny. If any of you have ever been to those, seen those statues at the missions, they're all the same kind of, they're these mass-produced statues of the missions. Those are life-size. He was a short little dude, and he could barely reach the lectern at the Franciscan House of Studies where he was studying. He was, he had two very interesting things, and this is, I was telling Father Isaiah Mary, he was definitely a Franciscan, but he acted a lot like a Dominican, particularly in his zeal for study. He was a philosopher, actually. He got a doctorate in philosophy. And this philosophical doctorate was in especially the philosophy of Raymond Lull and Scotistic philosophy. So a little bit different than what we study as Dominicans. That's a whole nother session we can do on that if you want every one day. But and this life of study, and he got a doctorate and settled down to be a teacher. But he had a heart for preaching, and he would spend the summers and any free time he had giving missions. Now you might think, okay, why does he need to preach missions? This is, I mean, Mallorca is a very Catholic place. Yeah, so I mean, you needed to re-evangelize even then, right? You needed to inflame the faith of those who were seeking to hear it. And one of the things he preached on early on, way before it was popular, divine mercy. He was a real big proponent of this notion of the mercy of God. And you know, we are sinners, but God loves us that much. And he also had a love of music, although it was said that he was not a very good singer, but he loved to sing. And so apparently he would always insist on singing the mass, even though his brothers would cringe a little bit because he wasn't that great. And this love of learning. But he had a heart for the missions, and that heart would never turn off. And he kept pondering this. So he got his doctorate, he's teaching, he's in his mid-30s, and he feels this desire to go to the missions. So he answers the call. He's going to go to the New World to preach the missions. And his desire was to go where the gospel really had never been preached before. He wanted to be a St. Paul type of person, go to those who had never heard the light of the gospel. And again, it was because he really believed that we should love those who are called to preach to. So he signs up for the missions, but he's too scared to tell his aging parents. Because in those days, unlike now, if you become a missionary, that's it. You said goodbye, and you would die in the missions. That was you, it was the goodbye until heaven, right? And so he was too chicken to say goodbye to his parents. So what he did was he got on the boat, and he wrote them the goodbye letter from the boat. The boat went from the Balearic Islands, from Mallorca, out to Spain. And it was on that journey that he said goodbye, wrote his letter. He wrote it to his sister, actually. He couldn't even say it to his parents. He wrote the letter to his sister. And we have a copy of that letter. There are watermarks in the bottom because he was crying while he was writing it, because he was going to miss his family so much. It was very touching for me because I'm from a very close family myself. He gets to Spain and basically puts into port, waiting for the boat to Mexico. It was the only time he was ever on the Spanish mainland. Makes the long journey to Mexico. He lands in the port of Veracruz, and they offered to take him by coach or on a donkey or on a horse from Veracruz up over the mountains through Puebla to Mexico City. Him being a good Franciscan, absolutely not. I'm going to walk. Then happens something that would haunt him for the rest of his life. On this trip, something happened. Something happened in the middle of the night. We think he got bit by a mosquito, but he may have been bit by a snake. This wound got infected really quickly, and he had a high fever. They thought he was going to die. He didn't die, but it basically left him lame for the rest of his life. And he insisted on walking, but he walked with a limp, and that leg wound would keep getting reinfected for the rest of his life. So it was definitely a source of pain. It was something that he offered up, though, for the salvation of souls, seeing that in suffering, even in physical suffering, can be redemptive. More on that later on, because it actually comes into one of the controversies I'm going to talk about. He gets to Mexico City, and he goes to the place where the missionaries were sent out, which was the Colegio San Fernando. Okay, so the way that these worked, missionaries would come to the New World, and there would be a colegio where you would sort of learn how to be a missionary, and in that you would learn, like, grammatical structures of native tribes. You would learn customs. You would learn things to watch out for, survival tactics, architecture. You would learn agriculture. You would learn animal husbandry, all kinds of stuff you'd need to know on the missions. So he goes to the Colegio San Fernando. He shows up ready for the missions. And what do his brothers see? Hey, look, we got another guy with a doctorate in philosophy, because Colegio San Fernando was also a house of studies. It was a studies for guys preparing for the priesthood. And I'm like, great, we got another professor. Your job is to be a professor. So he came there with a missionary heart, and he gets stuck being a professor. So he's teaching, and he's obedient, and he would devote his summertime, and again, like he did in Mallorca, and summertime and break time, to going and preaching missions throughout central Mexico, even over into Puebla and down into Oaxaca, if you know Mexican geography. But he wanted to go to the missions. He finally got a chance to go to some missions called the Sierra Gorda missions, which are sort of north of Mexico City. And he was there for a few years. They'd already been missionized, though. People there had already heard the gospel, and it was sort of maintaining these mission structures. He did that, and he built some beautiful churches there in Jalpan and other churches in towns in the center of Mexico. Came back to San Fernando, taught a little bit more, and finally he got his chance to go to the New World. Finally, this chance to go to the places where people had never heard the gospel before. This happened why? The Jesuits got expelled from the Spanish Empire, 1767, very important date. So the Jesuits get expelled from the Spanish Empire, and the Jesuits, remember I said, had the care of the northern part of Mexico as their mission territory, including up into what is now Arizona. The famous mission San Javier del Bac was one of the Jesuit missions. And they had started building missions up the string of Baja California, up the peninsula. And they had established a number of missions. A number of them had failed, but they got a few off the ground. Baja California has very few natural resources. The population was small, and it was rough going for these missions. Nonetheless, Junipero Serra embraced it, got there, and thought, ooh, this is not that great. He was able to found one more mission in 1767, San Fernando Velacata in Baja California, in addition to the Jesuit missions that had been started. And then something happened that involves the Dominicans. Dominicans are not usually great on land deals. So we showed up in 1767 and said, hey, we want to get in on this mission activity with you. The Jesuits have left. We want to get in and help. Then my patron kind of pulled one over on us. He said, tell you guys what, we'll give you the deal. We'll take the hit. We'll give you these missions that are already started here in Baja, and we'll go up to these other places that have never been missionized, like Santa Barbara, San Diego, Monterey, Carmel, San Juan Capistrano. They knew that these places existed. Of course, these are much more lively places in terms of resources and things. The Dominicans came in and we had a really rough go, but we nonetheless completed the chain. So if you go into Baja California, you can actually see a string of Dominican missions, ones that we finished for the Jesuits and ones that we actually built anew, going all the way up. And the dividing line between Franciscan and Dominican territory is what later was used by the United States and Mexico in the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo, more or less, to divide the international line between the United States and Mexico. Saint Junipero Serra crossed into Alta California with an expedition led by Galvez and also Portola, familiar names to those of us who are Californians. And he crossed in on July 1st, 1769. That's why his feast day, by the way, is on July 1st and not on the day of his death, which was in August. Crossed into California, and he founded the first mission at San Diego. Then he headed north and founded a second mission a year later at San Carlos in Monterey. One thing he discovered, though, very quickly, he discovered that having missions next to presidios was a problem. What's a presidio? The Spaniards organized California into military districts, and they put a fort over each military district. So San Diego, Santa Barbara, Monterey, and San Francisco, I think, were the four districts eventually. In those four districts, they had these forts, and San Diego and Carmel missions were initially founded next to the presidios, but he was worried for the virtue of, especially the native peoples who came to these missions, was worried about their virtue because the Spanish soldiers, he was worried, would try to take advantage of them, particularly the women in sexual ways, but also just exploitive of these native populations. And he realized that it could be problems because, of course, California was a mishmash of different tribes, right? California was like 200 Native American tribes all up and down the state. And they were different languages. They also had local feuds. And he realized that if he moved a mission away from the Presidio, it could be dangerous, but nonetheless, it was the best for the natives. So nonetheless, he moved them away. San Diego, there was a fight. There was an uprising by some of the mission Indians, and there was also joining with some of the other tribes. The tribe near San Diego was extremely warlike, and they killed a priest. They killed a Franciscan priest there, often called California's first martyr. Father Jaime, as he's often called, or Jaime in the Catalonian dialect. He's buried in the floor at Mission San Diego. The Spaniards wanted to do some reprisal killings. They wanted to kill 8 leaders of the tribe there and also scourge a bunch of others. Junipero Serra heard about this and went very quickly to San Diego and stopped the killings. And he said, no, we should act with mercy. We shouldn't be acting this way. And priests have actually, and historians have actually said he was the first person in America against capital punishment, right? Even though it wasn't America at that time. He went on to establish 9 missions. His great hope was to establish a mission in the Santa Barbara Channel. Of all the California missions, I'd have to be careful I say this, of all the California native tribes, the Chumash Indians who were down there in the Santa Barbara Channel had a much more kind of quote-unquote advanced linguistic system, hunting system. And part of it was because they were seafarers. They went out to the Channel Islands from the shore. So they developed these really good techniques in sort of rowing, canoes. And the Spaniards knew about this, and it was Junipero Serra's desire to really go there, because he knew that he thought that some very prosperous missions could happen there. Unfortunately, if you do that, you've got to really know all the things to know about that society. And so they put off the founding of that mission until later. And eventually 4 missions would be founded there. The first one being San Buenaventura, the very last mission Junipero Serra founded. Very quickly, because I know we're almost out of time. So his missions were San Diego in the south, Carmel, number two, or Monterey, number two. Number three, San Antonio de Padua, in the middle of nowhere. Closest mission to my hometown of Coalinga. So if you know Coalinga, Father Isaiah Mary knows that a little bit. That's the closest mission, and it's still in pristine condition, out in the middle of nowhere, one of my favorite missions. San Gabriel, which is now down in the heart of Southern California, right, just east of East LA. Number five, San Luis Obispo, which we all know from the Central Coast. Number six was our own mission here, San Francisco de Assis. By the way, when the Spaniards found this, it was Portola coming overland, looking for Monterey Bay. He missed it, and he came over the mountains down south on the peninsula, and he said, oh, there's something else here. This is huge. That was number six, was San Francisco. Number seven, San Juan Capistrano, one of the most successful and prosperous missions down in the south. Number eight, Santa Clara University mission, which is the mission, became later Santa Clara University. And number nine, the last mission founded in Alta California, San Buenaventura, which is now Ventura. He gave permission for the founding of Santa Barbara, which was the 10th mission, and he died in 1784. And he was buried in the building, the Rising Church at Carmel. And he's in the floor there of the Basilica today, right in front of the high altar. By the way, he loved the liturgy and beauty so much that he was dying. And for last rites, he insisted on putting on a surplice and a stole, going to the unfinished church. He made the Franciscans sing the Adorote and the Tantum Ergo. And then he made sure that he was carrying a candle and made incense be used too. So he loved the liturgy. He wanted the full thing. One of the reasons I liked him too. He brought the first library to California as well, which is now at the Carmel Mission. I want to touch really quickly on some of the controversial points, and then we can maybe open up for questions. Is that okay, Trish?
Yes, okay. Father. You have more time if you need some as well.
Okay. Controversial points. First of all, the false points. Whenever I post something about Junipero Serra and trolls pop up on the internet, one of the first things, he enslaved Native Americans, he raped them, and he killed them. So these are all lies. He did not rape anybody. In fact, he would go after soldiers who even tried that and have them either hanged or would have them scourged, usually scourged. Any soldiers who even tried to do any exploits against natives, especially sexually. And he did not own slaves. There was no slavery here. Now, people, then we got to go move on to the controversial parts. People say, well, he went after runaway mission Indians. Isn't that the same thing as going after a runaway slave? Okay, people who own slaves, who go after runaway slaves, view them as their property. This may seem subtle, but it's important to understand the reasoning behind this. Junipero Serra advocated going after those who were running away. I'm not advocating this, but this is why he advocated it. There's a notion in Christian thought, going back to the scriptures themselves, to the letters, epistles of St. Peter, saying that if one were to convert to Christianity and then relapse into a life of sin, and especially into a life of paganism, as this often was interpreted, it would have been better for that person not to have become a Christian in the first place. And so the thinking behind this was, if somebody ran away, they would then revert to paganism. And then this would be, it would actually put their soul at risk. And so the kinder thing to do would be to get them to bring them back. Now, again, I'm not advocating that. I think that was a wrong thing. It was a wrong, but it's important to understand why he advocated for this. Number two, he did advocate for what we would now term corporal punishment. So for those who were disobedient, he advocated scourging. And for those who broke laws, scourging. But it's important to remember a few things about this. He also advocated that for Spaniards who broke the law. And soldiers were routinely scourged in the Spanish Empire as part of, and especially sailors, as part of the punishment system. Another thing, and this is, I think, hard for people to get their minds around sometimes, he scourged himself, as did most of the Franciscans at that time, Dominicans at that time too, actually. It's called the discipline. You can see this, it was done into the 20th century. It's kind of a piece of wood with knots on it, and to hit yourself. And it was actually considered to be a good spiritual practice as a means of atoning for our sins. And so, again, we don't advocate this now. We don't advocate for people to scourge themselves or to scourge others. But that this was kind of the thinking, again, that that kind of suffering could actually even be redemptive. So again, it wasn't out of an essentially, we own you, but I do understand and see why this can be a controversial point. And that as well as the going after those who were runaways. It's important to recognize though too, he really loved the people he was going to missionize, that he was going to preach the gospel to. He saw in them that they were, because they were human persons, that they were worthy of the gospel. The gospel doesn't belong to some sort of clique that thinks that they're too advanced and they can read the gospels or whatever. The gospel doesn't belong to some sort of clique off in Europe or some other place. Everybody is worthy of hearing the gospel story and worthy of being able to accept it. The church proposes. And St. Junipero Serra really believed this, and he really did love the people that he was going to preach to. I think one of the first rules as we do evangelization, even today in our world, is we really have to love the people who we are going to evangelize. Our world is filled with a lot of people who hate others, right? From whatever political party you want to be. You see the rancor and the anger and the horrible discourse that goes on in our time. And St. Junipero Serra really did not, that just was not in his tapes. He loved the people that he was going to evangelize, even if they were going to rebel or act hostile or whatever it might be. Another important thing to remember about him, he was impatient for the whole mission too. Some of my favorite things about him, he was impatient about preaching the gospel. He was impatient with his Franciscan brothers. His Franciscan brothers couldn't stand it sometimes. There's a story from when he founded Mission San Antonio, the third mission. The first thing he did is he asked the soldiers to unpack a bell. So the soldiers unpacked the bell. And it was nighttime, it was getting to be dusk, and he starts ringing the bell. And the Franciscans said, "What are you doing? Why are you ringing this bell?" He said, "I want the people to come so we can start preaching now." And the Franciscans were like, "We don't know who the people are here. We don't know what their language is. We don't know if they're hostile. We don't know if they're going to hate us. We don't know anything. I mean, let us get a night's sleep." Well, they showed up that night, and they had to begin the mission then. He was extremely impatient. His motto is adelante, siempre adelante, which is sort of roughly translated, go forward now, always, always move, get out there, adelante, move. And which I've always really appreciated. Father Isaiah Mary, who lives with me, knows that that's one of the things I struggle with is patience myself. Another thing we have to remember is that he led with beauty. He led with beauty. He didn't want to just build some sort of bland building and say, okay, now we're going to come and we're going to preach you the truths. It wasn't just a head trip. It was really engaging the whole person. And beauty is the thing where theology, philosophy, moral life, all these things can unite together in the beauty. Guys, because truth is beautiful, right? So he insisted that beautiful buildings be built, that beautiful vestments be used, and good music be put into them, including compositions. There's actually a piece that I would like Trisha to play. So the last piece is called Para Dar Luz Inmortal. It comes from the Santa Clara Mission, which was the eighth mission founded by Saint Junipero Serra in Alta California. And it is about Saint Joseph. So Trisha, if you're able to get that started.
Yeah.
Thank you, Trish. So that is, by the way, that the music group singing that, as well as the last piece, was Chanticleer, which is, of course, a San Francisco group. The founder of Chanticleer, Maestro Luis Botto, was buried from St. Dominic's Church, San Francisco. I was one of the organists for his funeral. Chanticleer has done a lot as a performing group to make great recordings of this music from the Mexican Baroque and also from the California Mission period. So if you ever want to discover more of the music from that, Chanticleer is the place to go. They're available on iTunes, all places, Apple Music. I want to also say, I want to go back to his lame leg before I turn it over to big questions. He loved the people he was coming to preach to so much that he would actually intervene against the Spanish authorities. There was at least one time that he traveled, walked, again, he was Franciscan, all the way from Carmel down to Mexico City on that lame leg to get a Spanish military governor removed because of the way he was treating the natives. He really, really did believe that it was problematic to exploit those whom he was called to preach to. And he was a stickler for it, and he would go after anybody who was trying to be exploitative, even at peril of his life and his own health. He's kind of a manly saint, you know. I mean, he was not afraid of trekking across wilderness and crazy places, and you know, I mean, and always in danger of death. And nonetheless, you know, here was this academic preacher who felt called to the peripheries of the world. And his territory of missionizing, of preaching, conversion, is our territory that we in the Western Dominican province have today. So that's kind of an end of my, that's a very long presentation. I could talk hours and hours more. But are there questions that people might have? I see that there's some chat stuff already going. Trish?
Yes, thank you so much, Father. I would love to hear you chat on at some other time. That was wonderful. We do have some questions, so I'd like to invite David Therian.
Hi, David.
So I'll ask David's question. So David's question is two parts. One is, did Saint Junipero Serra found the mission in San Rafael? And also, could you speak to what the missions were like that were founded? Did Saint Junipero Serra institute education, teach skills in farming, and other skill sets?
So really quickly, San Rafael was founded originally from the mission here in San Francisco. It was founded because the climate's a little bit nicer over there in San Rafael. It's protected by Mount Tam. And so it was founded as kind of a hospital place. One of the big problems with the missions, and this is a real big issue, is that there are massive diseases. You know, whenever the natives came in contact with Europeans, disease was rampant. And so to find a place to help treat those who were suffering from disease, San Rafael was founded. It didn't become an independent mission until much, much later. So he didn't found it as an independent mission, but it was founded from a mission that he founded. The second question was about,
what were the missions like? What kind of things?
Yes, okay, so the skills. Yeah. Certainly, okay, unlike in Central Mexico and in South America, where you had a lot of places where the native populations were agricultural, California was not. It was, for lack of better terms, what we used to call hunter-gatherer types of peoples. And so they taught farming. Again, California issue with water. So early irrigation stuff, dams, some of these water systems are still used. Actually, the Santa Barbara city still uses part of the mission water system there. And certainly farming, animal husbandry, how to breed cattle, how to keep a sustainable food source. Language, one of the things that a lot of the friars tried to do was to make lexicons, to understand and write down and codify the grammars and the systems of the native languages. Unfortunately, many of those languages died out. We're talking tribes of 50, 100, 150 people, and you know, that language, these were very isolated kind of groups of people, and often if a disease went through, you might lose the language quickly.
Great. Thank you so much, Father. The next question is from Stephanie. Stephanie, can you unmute yourself and ask your question to Father James, please?
Sure. My question was, I wasn't sure if you said that he scourged natives or not, and if he did, what were the reasons he might have done that? You were clear on the Spaniards, but not for the natives. Thanks.
Right. Thanks. So I'm not sure if he personally ever did that. There might be records of that. I'm unsure of that exactly. But he did. He was okay with it. And it would have been for basically any sort of judicial infractions. So you know, stealing, thievery, certainly immorality, and also for, again, leaving the missions. If you had somebody that was running away constantly, or somebody that was kind of causing trouble in like an uprising or something like that, again, it was sort of for a matter of discipline, like, type of thing. Good question.
Thank you, Father. Another question is, how old was Saint Junipero Serra when he arrived in the New World, and how old was he when he crossed into California?
He was about 36 when he arrived in the New World, and I think he was 55 when he came to Alta California, which is pretty old. I mean, for starting a brand new thing like that, you know what I mean? And coming into the middle of nowhere, but he didn't care.
Yeah, that's great. From Angela. Angela, could you ask your question about the theology behind self-flagellation? Okay, so Angela's question was, can you unpack the theology and spirituality about the discipline of self-flagellation? And when did it cease among the Franciscans and why?
Okay, so I'm not an expert at this, I have to say. And so this is going to be just a really, really brief thing. It's akin to the theology of fasting and mortification. You know, we deny ourselves all sorts of things. And so it was akin to, a lot of people would wear hair shirts. People would wear maybe a chain around themselves. So it's an old Christian practice. Basically, what would do is it would remind you of God. So if you wore a hair shirt when you were uncomfortable and scratchy, you thought about God. When you're fasting and your stomach is empty, you think about God. When you hit yourself with a rope, you think about God, and especially for your sins. Correct me if I'm wrong, Father Zamir, I don't know if you know this, but I think that flagellation might have gone into the 20th century, from what I can remember about this. Again, I'm reaching way back to stuff I read.
I would agree with you. Yeah, I mean that, in fact, in the archives, we actually still have a couple, actually. So
right, so we did it in our province. Yeah, mm-hmm. We found it in 1850 here.
Yeah.
And I've actually seen a Franciscan whip in Hong Kong at their priory there. Okay, so the next question is, why is Saint Junipero Serra buried in Carmel?
Okay, so that was his headquarters. It's a short answer. You know, so you see Dominicans, those of you who are familiar with us here, Dominicans tend to live in communities, as do Franciscans. One of the problems with the missions constantly, this is a problem with our Dominican missions too, those communities in the frontiers were like two. And so like, I think at Carmel, they usually had three or four, but most of the rest of them were like two or three. There was even one beautiful case at San Luis Obispo. They had two friars and like five soldiers. And one of the two friars died. So Saint Junipero Serra, he heard from the other priest who buried him, and said, I'm really lonely, I'm really depressed. And Junipero Serra cared about his brother so much that he actually went down there and actually spent the rest of the time until he could get 6 months until he could get another priest. So basically, Junipero Serra happened to be there when he died in Carmel, and that's where he was buried. In those days, you were buried where you dropped.
Great, thank you. The next question is from Rochelle. Rochelle?
Oh, hello. So you mentioned Mary at the beginning, but did Mary play any more roles during the missions?
Oh yeah, I mean, you know, the friars were very, very devoted to the Blessed Mother, and every mission church had a Marian shrine, and especially music to our Blessed Mother. What you heard at the very beginning was something interesting. If you heard that was sacred music, but it was written in Spanish, right? And remember, the liturgical language at the time was Latin. But there were some services that actually would be held in the vernacular, namely the little office of the Blessed Mother, which, you know, for those of you who know St. Dominic's, we chant the divine office. The little office was a smaller version of the office done in the vernacular. And the matins for that was the little matins, or mañanitas, who we often hear about. So that piece was written for the mañanitas. It was written as a responsory for the service of the little matins. That one on Saint Joseph was a devotional piece again, because there would be devotional services in the vernacular to Saint Joseph. So again, not necessarily for the mass, but for other services that were devotional. So they did music both in Latin and in the vernacular. And also there are interesting things that you find in Mexico of music in praise of Our Blessed Mother in Nahua and in other native languages, which is really incredible stuff.
Great, thank you. The next question is from Dominica.
Yeah. Hello, Father.
Hello.
I wanted to ask you about the architectural style of the missions. I'm a California native. I love this style. Mm-hmm. And I think it's so unique to California. It has these Spanish roots, but it's I think it's very simplified. I wanted to ask you, did the Spaniards bring craftsmen and builders, or like how did they get to this aesthetic, you think?
Yeah, so short answer is yes. But again, and you're right. I mean, for us who are native Californians, right, the mission architecture just, it blends so well with our just natural landscape, like with the sun, you know, with the ocean, and we have a Mediterranean climate. But yes, the Spaniards did bring artisans, but they also taught native peoples how to create art. And what emerged was not just a slavish copy, but often like with sort of native kind of twists. So if you go to the Carmel Mission, you can look at the window there, which is this kind of this star-shaped window, mm-hmm. but it's a little bit crooked, right? So they had engineers, but they weren't perfect. The tower is this Moorish-looking tower. Remember, Spain had Islamic influence. So it's a Moorish-looking tower, but it's not exactly proportioned exactly right. So yes, they brought, and these priests not only had to be philosophers, theologians, preachers, agrarian people, people who did farming and animal husbandry and medicine, but they also had to be architects and engineers.
Mm-hmm. Awesome.
I have a question from Maria Cecilia.
Hi, Father.
Hello.
I wanted to know how is he remembered in the Native American culture?
That's a good question. It's a very mixed bag. Now, something interesting, I find that there are a number of Native Americans, including friends of mine, who I grew up with, who don't have a very high opinion of him. There are other Native Americans who have a very high opinion of him. I have not seen, though, any record of Natives having a low opinion of him that goes back more than about 30 or 40 years. So I don't know what that's about. I don't know if it's revisionist history. I don't think that's been studied enough. California Natives, after Junipero Serra, after he died and after Mexican period began, suffered very, very horribly. During the Mexican period, they quote-unquote secularized the missions, say, we're going to give the missions over to the Natives, and then the Mexican rancheros quickly swindled the land away from them. They fled inland, and then when when California became part of the United States, a lot of times they were massacred. One of the first governors of California, Governor Burnett, said something very awful. He put out a bounty, $5 for a scalp, $50 for a head of an Indian. And so they formed battalions and they slaughtered wholesale. Many of the natives fled to the mountains, where later on they were actually protected by a Dominican priest named Padre Blanco. So that's a long answer, I'm sorry. But I don't see any record of negativity by native persons that goes back more than 40 or 50 years. Now, it might just be an awakening of cultures. It's complex as to how that is, but there are definitely, though, I know a number of natives who are hugely fond of Saint Junipero Serra. In fact, the first reading at his canonization was read by a native of the Ohlone tribes, which is one of the local tribes here, in the Ohlone language.
That's beautiful. Thank you so much for sharing, Father. We have a question from Alexander.
How did Father Serra become canceled in today's world, and why are his achievements overlooked today?
How did he become canceled?
Yes, with people like turn down his statues and stuff.
Oh, okay. It's canceled of like
It's a new phrase being used, canceled culture, this idea of getting public social media against people.
Okay, I think that's really mob mentality is very problematic because, first of all, it's generally speaking irrational. I mean, you can have a debate and you could talk and really bring up points and make arguments and counter-arguments. That's an important thing. I think this we do as a democratic society. And also, actually, to be honest with you, as a Catholic Church, we've done this. But to have just a mob rise up, Alexander, to answer your question, I think a lot of times it's due to an ignorance. It's due to this whole concept of being canceled or unlearned instead of like learning more and sort of figuring out the nuances and saying, okay, there are some things that weren't that great. Sometimes saints sin, sometimes saints mess things up. Every saint except for our Lord and the Blessed Mother himself was herself were that way. So I think that that's one of the problems that his achievements are overlooked because people it's a mob mentality, and it's also taking kind of where our sensibilities are now and trying to project them back instead of trying to look at objective goodness and truth and why things happened.
Thank you. And our final question for tonight, and I'm sorry for those who haven't had a chance to ask questions, there have been a lot of interest, is from Julia.
Yes, can you guys hear me?
Hi, Julia.
Hi. I'm a teacher, and I'm curious about your recommendations for how to teach California history, given all the controversies surrounding Father Serra and the missions, and whether or not you have any primary source recommendations or books that you would recommend that a teacher use.
Yeah, primary sources, there are some. His parts of his diary are available, and I don't think it's all translated, though. I think most of it is actually in Spanish. Also, another early source, although it's very hagiographical, basically it was written so that he could be canonized, was one of his best buddies, Francisco Palou. We have his Life of Serra, which is a multi-volume thing. But one of the best books I can recommend to you that I think really does justice, including the controversies, is a book, and I can give you this link later, Trish, but it's, I don't know if anybody can see this. This is, it's by two professors from Santa Clara, Bob Senkewicz and Rosemary Beebe. They are not by any means political in terms of like liberal conservative or pushing or not pushing. They really do, they're good historians. The book was published in 2015. Trisha, I can send you the link if you want to send it out as an email.
I have that book. I was there for their talk.
Well, you were. Okay, excellent.
Yeah.
I actually knew Bob when I was at Santa Clara. And so I've run into him a couple times and I've told him how much I like the book, how much I've used the book. It's a long book, but it has good references in it and stuff like that. So tons of footnotes, tons of endnotes. I highly recommend it. Again, it's not something that's not hagiographical. There's also, it's critical of him, but to a good point, he's a very Catholic author, Kevin Starr. Who is the former librarian of the state of California who wrote a multi-volume work on California history and also one volume sort of summary of California history. Kevin Starr's books are widely available, and Kevin Starr is buried here in St. Dominic's Church. His widow, Sheila Starr, is a good friend of Father Isaiah Mary and myself and all the friars. Kevin, he doesn't pull any punches with Junipero Serra. At the same time, I think he does a fair job in presenting the history, and I would highly recommend him. As someone who's maybe, he's enthusiastic about him, but not like I am.
I actually, because I was at the talk they did at Stanford University, and I just want to add one thing that I think was really important that touched me when they gave a talk, because there was a student there who was very upset, you know, from one of the more recent 30 or 40 years of revisionist history and whatnot. And I still remember there was an elderly gentleman who was also of a more direct Native American lineage. And he had tears in his eyes when he began to speak of Saint Junipero Serra and the very many missionary priests who sacrificed so much to bring the gospel of Jesus Christ, because he said, my salvation, my relationship with Jesus Christ, and that of my fathers and my forefathers and all of my family, we owe all of our faith in Christ to the valiant and courageous efforts of these missionary priests like Saint Junipero Serra, who sacrificed everything to come and bring this gospel of light and love to us. So he was, that's what he spoke about. And to me, that's really spoke to the heart of a missionary and their impact in people's lives.
You know, I would just add to that, I've worked especially with Native Americans in Arizona quite a bit, and did some very, you know, was involved with some very difficult and hard cases there. And they again, it's the faith in Christ that really is very, very moving, and to be able to often work in incredibly poor situations, exploitive situations, situations where even births were trying to be regulated. It was an awful situation, and really, they spoke so highly of the Catholic Church and were thankful for our witness, and that we're able to bring even still today. But the roots were in those missionary efforts. It definitely, that kind of respect, it's, we have to kind of, I think, listen to our elders sometimes. Also, Trish, can I add just a really quick plug for your own society?
Mm-hmm, yes, you're more than welcome, Father.
The Francis Xavier Missionary Society, which is doing some exciting things, has some exciting ideas, and is seeking to preach the gospel into what I hope and think will be one of the most fertile mission fields coming up, especially to the Far East. It's amazing to me. One of the most awesome experience I ever had was on a train platform in Washington, D.C. with some Catholic youth students, a girl coming up saying, "Are you Christians?" And I said, yes, she was Chinese. She said, "I'm Chinese. Can you please tell me about Jesus Christ? I've heard about him. I don't know who he is." And our Catholic youth students immediately started praying the rosary. You could see them off on the train. And I was just, I took the crucifix off my belt and showed it to her and said, you know, this is, he's God and man. He loves you. He died 2,000 years ago, but he's alive. And you need to know about him. You need to read this gospel. Where's, can I get a Chinese Bible? By the end of the train ride, one of the brothers had a Chinese gospel up on her phone for her. And we were ready to go. And I was like, we need to preach the gospel in the East. The mission field is ripe. And so to Trish and to all those who have done valiant work there today in sometimes very, very difficult situations. Of course, we're praying for Hong Kong right now and for the repression that's going on there and for the people of God there, especially the lots of Catholics there, including the very courageous cardinals and priests and bishops and sisters. So we want to pray for them and for the Missionary Society of St. Francis Xavier and all the work that you do there. And please support them. Please be on top of them. They rely on our support like everybody else. They're beggars.
Yes. Thank you so much, Father. I'll put a screen up in a minute so you can see how you can be a part of supporting our work and also other great upcoming events that we have coming up this summer. But before I do that, Father James, I would love to invite you to say a closing prayer and a blessing for all of us so that we may truly witness to our faith with the same kind of courage that Saint Junipero Serra did.
Absolutely. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Lord, we ask you to send your Holy Spirit upon all of us. And in these days of sickness and death, in these days of anger and strife and hatred, in these days of just complete seeming chaos and irrationality, we ask that you send your Holy Spirit, your Spirit of peace upon all of us, that we might be civil to each other, that we might dialogue with each other, that we might love each other, that we might care for each other, that we might help each other see the innate dignity in each and every person, especially those who are most oppressed. Help us to proclaim that mission of love, that gospel of redemption, that gospel of liberation from sin and death. Help us to preach it to each other, preach it to the whole world, that all might become the saints that we are called to be. And may Almighty God bless and keep you all, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. If anybody wants to get a hold of me, Trish, please let them have my email or whatever, okay?
Great. Thank you so much, Father James. It's such a blessing to have you. I want to just briefly invite Laura to just share a moment of how meaningful it was for her to have St. Junipero Serra in her life.
Thank you, Tricia. So I am from Spain. I come from the Mediterranean, and I live in Petra, that is where the hometown of Junipero Serra. I was in the church where he was ordained, and I wish you could see the library. They have a very amazing library in the in the basement, and you can find books of 1,700. So it's a real relic. As a Spaniard and lover of Junipero, I truly, deeply thank you all for putting this event and getting closer to people what the legacy is about and the missions. I was confirmed in St. Dominic's in San Francisco 3 years ago. Mm. And after being confirmed, I took a whole month off and I did a road trip doing all the missions and talking to, you know, the people who were working, the clergy, everybody who was representing the mission, even the person who was selling the tickets. And I have been almost in every corner of this world. I have traveled everywhere. And the most amazing two places for prayer to me is where he's buried in Carmel. And there is another mission that I really find the connection and is San Luis de Francia in Oceanside. Mm. And in San Luis, you can sleep, you can spend the night there. In San Juan Capristiano, you can sleep too. So I spent both nights in the missions. And it's amazing because as a Spaniard, I can tell you that every single corner, decoration, the portraits, the figures, everything is truly, truly related and linked to my origin, the roots, everything. I could feel even the gardens and everything are really unique in that aspect. So thank you so much especially to Father Isaiah for inviting me and for getting closer with all this topic. Thank you.
Thank you, Laura. And especially thank you so much, Father James Junipero Moore, for being with us tonight. And all of you who came, again, we are the light that we can bring Christ to the world. We are the ones who can set the record straight about Saint Junipero Serra and so many other missionary priests. We are called as the laity to transform the culture from within, to truly be like leaven, just as Lumen Gentium said in Vatican II. So thank you again so much. If you would like to support our missionary work and also other programs like this one, I invite you to scan a QR code, go to our website, and offer a donation so that we can continue to offer these kinds of ministry programs to help us grow in the knowledge of our faith and also bring the gospel to those places where the church is persecuted, where even priests and sisters are not able to freely go, and other places where people have never even heard the name of Jesus Christ. So thank you so much for your support. There's no better time than the present where we really need to see how we are called to live as witnesses to Christ's hope. And again, thank you, Father James Moore, and also to all of the Western Dominican friars who do such great work here, laboring together for the salvation of souls. Thank you so much.
God bless you.